Good morning. Really good to be back. I'm Nicky Campbell. Welcome to a new series of The Big Questions. Today we're live from London. Welcome everyone to The Big Questions. On Wednesday, two Islamic extremists strode into the office of the satirical magazine Charlie Hebdo and shot dead 12 people and injured 11 more, shouting, "We have avenged the Prophet Muhammad." The attack appeared to be punishment for the journalist and cartoonist who'd lampooned Islam repeatedly over many years. Another policewoman and four people taken hostage on Friday at a kosher supermarket also lost their lives to a third Islamist terrorist before police and special forces shot them dead. Now, this sent shockwaves across the world, shockwaves of horror, shockwaves of fear. Individuals and organizations across the world rallied under the banner "Je suis Charlie," but no major news outlets were prepared to adopt "I'm Spartacus" tactics by actually showing the cartoons that the attackers had found so offensive. A fear of reprisal seemed to outweigh wholehearted commitment to freedom of expression. Does freedom of speech give the right to offend? Douglas Murray from The Spectator, if you'd been a newspaper editor, would you have done this? Would you do this? Because surely it would be reckless, and you would be putting, as Stephen Pollard said this week, you would be putting the lives of your staff at huge risk.
Well, first of all, we have to remember what's going on here. This is an attempt, a very clear, very bloody attempt, to impose Islamic blasphemy law in France and across Europe. And it has to be stopped. That's why these men did it. That's why the journalists of Charlie Hebdo are dead. An attempt to impose Islamic blasphemy law in Paris. The problem is that unless you have an "I am Spartacus," as you say, tactic on it, it's not worth any one individual or any one, well, let's put it this way, no one publication doing it, because, you know, after the Danish cartoons affair, Charlie Hebdo was the only paper in the world, really, that continued to say it is our right as secular French citizens to draw, lampoon, laugh at, write about whatever we want. We're free people in a free society. They were the only ones who held on to that. And obviously on Wednesday morning we know what happened as a result. So any one publication would, I think, undoubtedly put its staff at considerable risk. That's why I've suggested this week, repeated what Ayaan Hirsi Ali said after the Danish cartoons affair. We have to spread the risk around. The free press in the free world has to spread the risk around. Our freedoms hang on this. It cannot be left to a single individual or a single publication, a single satirical magazine, to hold the line for all of our freedoms.
Raza Nadim, I come to you because you are scowling.
Yeah, because I disagree with everything he said so far. Because
everything?
Yeah, most of what he said, because I stopped listening after a while because it just didn't make sense. When he talks about we should, the news, Charlie Hebdo published whatever they wanted, that's rubbish. They were overtly racist towards Muslims. They were always lampooning Arabs and being overtly racist in most of the publications, and it smacks of hypocrisy because they were prepared, in the name of freedom of speech, to sack a journalist who wrote a column that they considered to be anti-Semitic. So how come there's a line there? But when it comes to Muslims, it doesn't matter, take it on the chin. Why are we treated differently from others?
Could I just answer that?
He was charged with a hate crime as well.
Sorry. It's really rich. There are 12 people dead.
Oh, please, don't try to use their deaths.
No.
Just don't.
Please,
don't try, because I just give you an example let me finish my point. They don't care for freedom of speech.
Okay, on that example,
Douglas
will address that example. If he doesn't, we'll make
a dozen.
And then I'll come back to you and ask you another question.
A dozen people were killed, and they're now being smeared as racists, like this gentleman here. And I think that's intolerable.
No, I did not.
He clearly knows nothing about Charlie Hebdo.
I just gave
nothing
you an example.
About France, nothing about French traditions of free speech. Charlie Hebdo is a left-wing, anti-racist publication. It has lampooned and does lampoon everybody. In recent years, it has taken particular delight in lampooning. Most of the attacks on Charlie Hebdo, the non-physical attacks, have been from the Catholic Church, repeated attempts to criminalise Charlie Hebdo for what it says about the Pope. Marine Le Pen, the far right-wing leader, is one of the main targets of their satire. You don't understand anything.
I just gave you an example.
Let me ask you a question. And then thereafter, we're going to spread the love, OK? As it were. Raza, Douglas touches on this. France has a long, some would say fantastic, certainly very proud tradition of vulgar and rude and anti-religious cartoons. Isn't it a cultural imposition for a minority to seek to change that?
Muslims
answer that question.
In France, in 2006, a rapper was prosecuted for saying, "I want to urinate on Napoleon." So where's this, in believing in a person, we can offend whoever we want? It's rubbish. Muslims are being asked to believe in freedom of speech more than others are, because in France they're prepared to prosecute an individual on that basis. They've banned comedians that they consider to be anti-Semitic. Now, I'm saying it's right. If someone's being anti-Semitic, stop them. But why, when we're saying someone is being Islamophobic and anti-Muslim, we're saying, take on the chin. Why are we treated differently?
Is there, if it's unacceptable, as many people feel it is, many people find it deeply offensive to see cartoons of the Muslim prophet Muhammad. Is there any way in which it is acceptable to poke fun at Islam?
If you want to poke fun, no one really cares. But the thing is, this isn't about poking
fun. We're not talking about cartoons. Is there any way?
Well, no, hang on. No, this wasn't about poking fun. This case is being painted as a freedom of speech issue, and it's clearly linked to the war on terror. If you look at the cartoon, the killers, what they say, we're part of Al Qaeda. It wasn't a cartoon that riled them up. It was foreign policy and the war on terror.
Why do you? Let me take it to Majid Nawaz. Majid, of course, you tweeted one of the Jesus and Mo cartoons. Most people would say it was relatively innocuous. It was a divine figure saying hello to a prophet and a prophet saying hello back again, basically. One of the other cartoons was slightly less innocuous. Yeah, less innocuous. That's the phrase I'm looking for. You had death threats. Answer Raza Nadeem's point.
Well, first of all, I just want to make it clear that not all Muslims define offence in the same way. Not all Muslims take offence at the same things in the same way. Muslims are not homogenous, and I don't claim to speak on behalf of Muslims, but I think likewise, nor should anybody else. So when somebody comes on this show and says, well, Muslims find that offensive, I think what they really mean is, I find that offensive because I'm very insecure in my own belief about God. The second point I'd like to make is that there is no right. Yes, there is a right to be offended. There certainly is no right to tell others or insist that others do not offend you. They are two very different things. Everyone is free to take offence at anything. I mean, people could take offence at my dress sense. But what they cannot do is insist that I dress in a way that doesn't offend them. They are two very different things, and that's important when discussing cartoons. The second thing to distinguish is that every idea is open to scrutiny. No idea, whether it's a philosophy or a religion, is immune or can be or should be immune from scrutiny. That's different from hate speech.
But would there not have been a very different attitude? Would there not have been a very different attitude to, for example, as there was anti-Semitic cartoons?
Well,
That's why I'm drawing this distinction, because first of all, Jews are a race, and anti-Semitism is stigmatizing a people. I've often said no idea is above scrutiny, and no people are beneath dignity. And if these were racist cartoons, then there's a legitimate conversation to be had about racism. The reason that I said I wasn't offended at the cartoon that you've just highlighted, it was a stick figure of a character called Jesus saying hello to a stick figure of a character called Mo. And the character called Mo said, "How are you doing?" The reason I picked that particular cartoon to say I wasn't offended at that is because it left no other option for people that take the view that this gentleman's taken except to say that's blasphemy. And what I suspect is that the issue at hand is, there's a separate debate about racial hate speech. The issue at hand is that many vocal, active, kind of communal, self-identifying, politicized Muslims will take an issue with blasphemy per se, and what they don't want is any depiction of the Prophet in any way.
Dan Hodges, in a minute, I must come back
to you. That's problematic, and that's
problematic. You've qualified freedom of speech.
Was that Jesus in Mo cartoon that he tweeted? Was that blasphemy?
I don't think it was blasphemy. But the thing is, it's, again, like you said, people may have different views. But the point is, he's qualified freedom of speech, saying it's all good apart from racism. That's bad. Well, hang on, then you don't believe in absolute freedom of speech, do you? You're saying that it's all relative at the end of the day.
They actually fired someone and charged him with a hate crime.
It's ridiculous.
Bring in Rose now, chaplain to the Speaker of the House of Commons.
We live in a civilized society, and I think it is important that we safeguard freedom of speech. Of course, freedom of speech from time to time is going to mean that somebody may say something that I'm going to find offensive, but it does not mean that I go out and shoot them. It does not mean that. And so, And I also think that we do need to be responsible in what, in some of the things that we say. However, as I say to my children when they were growing up, you cannot legislate for someone else's behavior or what they say. You can only decide how you are going to respond in that situation.
Which is more important, the humor, getting the laughs, or thinking about the people who are deeply offended by this?
Well, I think those who are doing humour, they're only thinking, I'm going to get a laugh out of this.
Yeah, that's why they fired a journalist.
You know, that's their particular thing.
Look, can I come in and say, as a rabbi, I don't like anti-Semitic cartoons, but I defend the right of people to make anti-Jewish or anti-women or other anti-remarks, because not only is it part of freedom of speech, but it also means that nothing is protected from scrutiny. And everything is open to criticism, whether it's rogue rabbis or paedophile priests
or
whatever. Pardon?
Holocaust
denial. Well, that's a historical difference. I think the real dividing line is you have a right to criticise, but you don't have a right to incite to violence. And when it goes from inspiring laughter to inspiring actual physical actions, so that's a dividing line.
Dan Hodges.
All these different lines.
Dan Hodges, if I may, we've not heard from Dan yet. I'm no doubt we'll hear from you again. Dan Hodges, columnist of The Telegraph. Are we cowed?
Well, to an extent, yes, we are being cowed, and I think this comes to the point of the point of the argument. It is ridiculous to say that we all have an absolute right to say what we like whenever we like it at any time. We don't. We have constraints on free speech, even outside of the religious sphere, which is why we have defamation laws, we have libel laws, things such as that. There are various factors which mitigate how we exercise our free speech. There's no doubt about that. The debate we are having here today is about should one of those factors be fear? Should one of those factors... It quite clearly is. Should one of the factors that influences our free speech be the fear that if we exercise our free speech, someone is going to come in and murder us? Now, you made a point, and I think there is some legitimacy in the point. If you look at the Charlie Hebdo cartoons in the whole, there are a number of their cartoons that I personally would be uncomfortable with. And I've seen the allegations that some of them bordered on racism. Fine. Let's put that to one side, though, for the moment. Let us focus just specifically on a cartoon which focused on a negative, or what was perceived to be a negative image, of the Prophet Muhammad. Do you think it is legitimate for a magazine like Charlie Hebdo or any other magazine to produce an image of that kind? Is it legitimate for them to do so?
If you're asking me to believe in freedom of speech more than other people are, then no, because they were prepared to ban someone when they wrote something anti-Semitic.
You
should believe in that more than everyone else, because Charlie Hebdo smacks of hypocrisy in their own actions.
And I'm removing the hypocrisy. I was being very specific. You have rightly said that there was censorship of people for racism. I accept that people should not be allowed to express
racism. Racist towards Arabs as well.
And I'm accepting that. But I'm saying on this specific point, on a cartoon that was not generically racist, a cartoon that just showed a specific image of the Prophet Muhammad, do they have a right to publish that?
Anyone has a right to publish anything if, though, you're going to treat everyone equally. Muslims aren't being treated equally when Charlie Hebdo... It's very clear. You can't separate the case from me, Dan. It's very clear.
Imagine to us.
Yeah, so you're saying anyone has the right to say, if they did publish a cartoon of the Prophet Muhammad that didn't have any racial...
Well, do the same about show black people in a bad light, show Jewish people in a bad light, but you aren't, though, right? No, because freedom of speech has limits.
Can I ask a question I was going to ask? If they did depict an image of the Prophet Muhammad that didn't have any racial stereotyping whatsoever, and so therefore it takes away that point, are you then supportive of that? Would you say, yes, that's fine, that's a good and legitimate question to ask the founder of a religion that's influenced billions of people across the world? It's legitimate to scrutinize any religion, including the Prophet Muhammad and Islam. It's legitimate.
Charlie Hebdo was not in the business of trying to get dialogue going. Yeah. He was looking to offend.
Douglas, in a second. Let's hear the audience. Lady back there with the blue top. Hello, good morning.
Good morning.
Quick points, please.
The point is, I'm just wondering, I get this idea, we have a Muslim and we have race. Muslim is a faith system, and therefore it's not a race. So we cannot use the word racism when we're talking about a religion, because it is a choice. Yeah. Your race is not a choice. And anything that you can convert to is not a race. So therefore we're looking at two different issues, and we're conflating two different ideas together to try and make a point that doesn't make sense.
Right there at the back. Hello.
I think the issue involved here is hypocrisy. Why? we tend to give the impression that everything we do, we can do it freely. If you are cooking, for example, there is a limited amount of salt we have to eat. You are driving on the road, there is a speed limit. Anything you have to do, there must be a limit. So freedom of speech cannot be without a limit. The issue here is...
Would you find, sir, these cartoons, a cartoon of the Prophet Muhammad, offensive?
I find them offensive, but I will not react the same way these people reacted.
No, of course, well, however, of course. Let me ask you another question, because the Guardian cartoonist, Martin Rowson, he was saying on Channel 4 News that he did want to do a cartoon of the Prophet Muhammad with a T-shirt on, Prophet Muhammad T-shirt, saying, "Not in my name," but he didn't feel he was able to do that. If he had done that, would you have found that offensive?
I have said it, and I'm repeating it here as a Muslim, that you can offend. You have the choice to retaliate or to forgive.
Would you have found that offensive?
Even if I find it offensive, I'm not going to react by killing
these
people.
I know that.
Right, that is the point.
I understand. However, let me bring it back if I can. Of course you wouldn't, but let me bring it back. People are worried about blasphemy here, sort of stealth. Through the back door, yeah. Or through the front door, whatever.
Very much through the front door. Can I just quickly... there are some people speaking about who have clearly sort of mugged up on Charlie Hebdo in the last couple of days and drawn from this tragedy whatever they like, but you really should know more if you're going to speak about this.
And I have shown more about it than you about this.
You're going to need to know more before you smear death cartoonists.
One thing you may not be aware of,
but it's worth throwing into the discussion, is that there are laws on the continent, particularly to do with anti-Semitism and particularly to do with the Holocaust. And let me just explain, because you may again not know this, but the historical reasons for that. France has historical reasons to be incredibly sensitive of anti-Semitism in particular, because within people's living memory, tens of thousands of Jews were put on the trains and slaughtered.
So we shouldn't be sensitive of Islamophobia?
No, let me explain.
Well, we shouldn't be sensitive of it. There's a secret website called Google. Let me finish the point. There are very specific reasons
in France and Germany why some of those laws exist. But let me get back to the main point which you've been trying to divert us from. That's this. What is going on with this is an attempt not to make Islam be treated differently, it wasn't to treat Islam differently or Muhammad, it was to treat Islam exactly the same way that secular free people have the right to talk about every religion. Some people through the front door with Kalashnikovs and others through the back door with this kind of weasel talk. What they do is try to make one religion free from being able to be criticised, and it must be stopped.
Well, people that are so insensitive are with you about their own religion. Taiwo, from Discuss Jesus, you would be unhappy about derogatory cartoons about Jesus Christ, wouldn't you? Told me earlier on.
I mean, I do subscribe to the fact that everyone's got a view. Everyone's got a right to their own opinion. But I kind of question the wisdom in all of this and the purpose in all of this. And what's interesting about the magazine is...
Well, the purpose of being so provocative.
Yeah, the purpose, yeah. What's the purpose? I mean, surely the aim should be that, you know, it can help the society to be progressive.
Harmonious, yeah.
Harmonious as well. And I think, if anything, mockery in all forms is non-progressive. It's poison. And I think what we have here is almost a self-combustion of the very fanaticism or the fundamentalism.
It's a joke. It's a laugh. It's freedom of speech. It's a bit of mockery. If you take out mockery, you take away comedy.
It's also a weapon
for truth. Yeah, I mean,
it's a weapon for truth, and that's sometimes why people don't like being lampooned, because it's actually too close to comfort, and it exposes ills that need to actually come out into
the light. Sorry, Rose, Kate's trying to come in.
I think there's quite an important point that seems to be sort of hinted at and not quite explicitly made, which is there's actually quite a big difference between lampooning Muhammad and the stories and ideas and ideals behind Islam as a sort of structure of thought and of belief. belief. And there's a difference between that and lampooning individual, ordinary people who are Muslim. That's quite different. In actual fact, there are 32 countries around the world where it is illegal to stop being a Muslim. So to assume that anybody who fits that label Muslim believes every word that is, you know, spoken by radical Islamists is, of course, completely wrong. And in fact, the first victims of extreme radical Islam are ordinary Muslims. And for their benefit, as much as everybody else's, we must continue to shred apart the ideas behind it and challenge it for their benefit as well as everybody else's.
No question, just throwing it to you.
For me, the example I refer to, again, it's a website called Google. If you go on that, you can find some examples of how Charlie Hebdo in the past has been hypocritical. No, let me finish my point, Majid. Let me finish the point without being sarcastic about it. And I'm allowed to be here. But it's in Charlie Hebdo, Nicolas Sarkozy, it was a case when they were hinting that he was converting to Judaism for financial gain, and that was considered to be anti-Semitic. Now, you're saying that we should be allowed to push the boundaries. There's some boundaries saying we can't be pushed, that shouldn't be pushed at all.
It's a choice to buy it, isn't it?
That's not the question. We're
isn't
not saying
a choice to read
the right to buy something that offends you, doesn't it? That's not the question that we're talking about.
It's disingenuous. We've already established the point that Muslims are not a race, and we've also already established the point, as Kate made so well, that there's a big difference between scrutinising a religion and its founder and picking on individuals. Muslims. No one here wants to pick on people. What we're talking about is the importance of scrutinizing ideas. Why is that so important? The reason it's so important is it happened to me last year. It happens to millions of Muslims across the world. Minorities within minority communities. There are feminist Muslims, there are gay Muslims, there are ex-Muslims, there are liberal Muslims, there are dissenting voices upon whom the charge of blasphemy is used, not just to silence them, but to actually kill them.
This
week,
blasphemy.
ISIL, on the streets of Iraq, publicly executed a magician for sorcery. The poor chap was a street musician attempting to make a quick buck because there's nowhere to find a job because ISIL are doing such a terrible job at running that place. And they executed him for sorcery. People use this excuse of Islamophobia, and it is an excuse. It's not Islamophobic to scrutinise a religion, just as it's not Christianophobic to scrutinise Christianity. But they want to silence minority voices. And it's to
there
resist
we
the charge
must,
of reform.
There we must leave it for now. And if you've got something to say about the debate, log on to bbc.co.uk/thebigquestions. Follow the link to where you can join in the discussion online or contribute on Twitter. Now, we're also debating live this morning from London, is serving time not enough to pay for crime? And should humanists have equal rights to religions? So please get tweeting or emailing on those topics now, or send us any other ideas or thoughts you may have about the show. Well, the convicted rapist, Ched Evans, will not be playing football for Oldham Athletic, nor for Sheffield United, nor for Maltese Hibernian. The pressure from sponsors, patrons, politicians and the Twitterati, or is it Twitterati, has proved too much for the clubs. Now, Evans might have scored them goals, but he would have also have cost them big money and a load of bad press. But Evans has served the usual half of his 5-year sentence and will remain on licence until it ends. And several other footballers have been allowed to return to the pitch after serving sentences for killing people through their dangerous or drunken driving. Does the court of public opinion have the right to countermand the Democrat-approved criminal or is serving time not enough? With Kate first, because we've heard you clearly laid out your credentials as an uber-liberal.
Oh, is that right? Yeah. is that what's appearing underneath my name
uber-liberal,
right now?
Yeah.
Uber-liberal,
you
yeah.
don't know that, but it is. Democrat, fair-minded. Does that fair-mindedness extend to Ched Evans playing football again?
No, for me it doesn't, I have to say. I think that there is a difference between somebody coming out of prison and being rehabilitated. I think somebody should indeed have the opportunity to get a job, but I don't think that extends to any job. If I might be so frank, there are crimes which, had you committed in the past, Nicky, you wouldn't be stood here in front of us because the BBC would quite reasonably go, who is the right person to front this show? And they would, you know, and they would use their judgment and exercise their judgment. I don't think we need a new law that decides, you know, what are the right and wrong jobs. jobs. I think that employers should exercise their judgment, and it depends on the nature of the crime and also depends on how they've responded to that. So, for example, if Ched Evans had come out of prison and wanted to say that he was very sorry about what had happened and that he accepted full responsibility and that he actually wanted to become somebody who gave lectures on rape culture and on the way that young people are being raised and on the importance of consent, I'd go, oh, great, he wants to be part of making a change. I'm happy for him to be in the public eye in that role.
Well, but
for
him just to come back... He's appealing the case, so, you know, he's restricted...
Well, he has appealed the case twice, and he's now taking it to yet another attempt. But he has appealed twice, and you know, or attempted to appeal twice, and been turned down now by five different judges in total, and, you know, and the original jury. So, you know, of course, you can always sort of try one more time.
It's within legal... It's within his legal rights to have one final go, though.
Oh, absolutely, but you know, it's innocent until proven guilty, not innocent until taken to yet another, you know, not innocent until he finally gives up trying to challenge the judgment. The ruling was guilty.
Dan Hodges, you wrote about this yesterday, didn't you, in the Telegraph? Is that right?
Yeah, that's
right. You've got to get the paper right.
Please do.
Do you think this is a delicate, a finely balanced debate, or do you think it's pretty clear-cut?
I think all debates have a degree of balance, but I think... Not in this case, in relation to the arguments put forward. I mean, I think the most interesting thing you said there was that we don't need laws about this, or we don't need rules about this. And we do. We need to be very clear that the penal system and the punishment meted out to offenders in crimes is regulated and codified by the state, not by the mob. And this idea that Ched Evans... The mob you referred to, the sort of the Twitter mob, the mob, the court of public opinion.
Is that not an expression of generally the tenor of public opinion? People on Twitter saying this.
Yes, but we can't have public opinion dictating how the legal system and the penal system operates. That has to be codified. It is perfectly.
So these are football clubs, and they survive on crowds coming to watch. And by the same token, if there was a pop star who had this terrible background, I think people would go, I don't want to go to that concert. I don't want to support that. And when the public are saying, I'm not going to go and watch Oldham Athletic if you've got this guy on the pitch, they're responding to the public expressing its opinion. I think we've just spoken about freedom of speech, and the public has a right to an opinion and a right to act on it, and a right to influence these kind of decisions.
The public, we all have a right to opinion. Obviously, we've just been discussing that, but as we've just also discussed, we don't always have an absolute right to everything. But I think it's perfectly legitimate for people to make their views known. I don't agree with the idea that what has resulted in the prohibition on Ched Evans playing is a public response. I think it's a response to a very successful and very focused campaign by a very vocal minority. And what it comes down to, if you strip it all away, is Ched Evans should not be allowed to play football because he is a role model. That is essentially the argument.
How could you put someone into a high-profile footballing position and not have them become a role model to young people? I mean, young children go to football matches.
One more from Dan. Hold back a while, Kate, because I want to bring other voices in.
Let me specifically answer that. Firstly, if you are holding up footballers and football as role models, then, frankly, you've got a problem. If the lesson you have drawn from the Ched Evans case is we should be holding up football as role models,
no, it's not.
Then that's not
so
the lesson.
So you've just not listened to what
I've
said.
Let me say one more thing. As I said, the rules about what offenders can do whilst on licence has to be codified. We cannot have a situation where we are asking the state to codify who our role models are.
Okay, listen, Roz. Please hold fire. You have a flaming, burning, passionate fire on this. Hold it a minute, or even a few minutes. I want to hear from Roz, and then I'm going to hear from Richard and also Julian Huppert there. Roz, CEO of Object, feminist campaign group. Hi.
Hi. I actually agree with Dan. You cannot have a mob controlling what people do. We have a mob that's called Men's Violence Against Women and Girls that controls and coerces and stops us living our lives freely. Let's talk about the problem of the woman who's had to move five times and change her name several times, her life chances, the woman who was a victim put in a court of law. Let's talk talk about the mob of Sheffield United football fans marching through the streets of Sheffield singing songs glamorising the rape of Ched Evans and the impact that that's had on the silencing of women who've been experienced violence. I think it's really important that there needs to be a proper regulation and rehabilitation of offenders. This conversation should be happening round the table of the Football Association and round the table of the Professional Footballers Association. That's the place where it should be happening. In the absence of that place happening, it is completely understandable that women and girls would be saying, enough is enough. And this man is, like it or not, he's a role model. I was sitting in a cafe very near here on Monday morning with a little boy who was going through his top trumps cards looking at football players, talking about these. Football players, we recognise football is a huge part of our culture. It's a huge part of a lot of people. Their team is who they are. It's how they identify. It sets a tone. With a situation fairly recently where an allegation that a footballer, John Terry, had used one racist word once was a huge public discussion about the appropriateness. And I think it's really important that a discussion about how sexism permeates football, also about not just about Ched Evans as an individual man, but what is it about the way that we're socialising footballers that they're going out and hunting in packs, having sex with groups of young women.
Which extends beyond footballers, clearly. But listen, a really important point there from Roz, a really important point. The Football Association have done sterling work when it comes to racism, stamping out racism, making racism absolutely unacceptable. Sterling work as well in the fight against homophobia. Surely this should be another example of that work.
This is not just for the Football Association. This is actually for us as a society. For goodness sake, this man is just kicking a ball around. Why is it that as a society, we have decided that this is a role model figure? Or, you know, he has served his time.
As a society, he's on license.
As a society, our laws have set out that he goes inside, that half of the time he's out, whatever that is. But you know, I want to preface this all by saying, I abhor the thought of any violence against women or children or anyone that's vulnerable. But the big elephant in this room and in our society that we are not addressing and that we all need to talk about is young people, or old people for that matter, who goes out there, choose to get drunk and behave in a manner that is detrimental, whether they are boys or girls or whatever they are,
Being drunk is not an excuse for being raped.
Well, hang on.
This is not about the victim. Of course it's about the victim. It's a disgusting thing to say. Let her clarify what she said.
I am talking, as far as the paperwork says, he was also drunk. They were drunk. What I am saying is that, when people are drunk, they don't know what they're doing. It is inexcusable. That behaviour is inexcusable.
Actually, there's another elephant in the room, and it's not just about Ched Evans. It's about anybody who comes out of prison, about 50 or 60 do every day, I'm speaking as a former prison chaplain, who find it impossible to rehabilitate to life.
Absolutely.
And the trouble is, we're very good at punishing people.
Yep.
We're actually not very good at reintegrating them. And we need to work much harder.
Richard Garside.
Ched Evans behaved in an appalling manner, and he received his punishment. He was sent to prison. The overview of what he's been doing or what he did, it's very common within society more generally. There is a major problem. I mean, I don't actually think the issue is about drunkenness. I think the issue is about male attitudes and boys' attitudes towards women, particularly if a woman's had a few drinks, then she's fair game. And if she's hooked up with your mate, then you can have a go too.
She should not be. That's disgraceful,
it's appalling, and it needs to be challenged and tackled consistently and systematically across society. The Football Association has an important role to play in that, potentially, the Professional Footballers Association and others. Now, I don't think that we resolve that problem by focusing on one individual called Ched Evans.
Absolutely.
I hadn't heard of Ched Evans before that case. I hope that we will reach a point where the only time we read about Ched Evans is in the back pages of newspapers rather than the front pages of newspapers. The way to resolve these issues is not to focus on one individual and to pursue him around the country as he tries to sign for successive clubs. The way to resolve this is actually to have a general conversation, and a big conversation, about male attitudes towards women and girls and what can be done about that. Now, if Ched Evans currently is a role model for boys, that's telling me that there is a major problem with the way that we view
masculine roles and what it is to be a
man. He's not a role model for boys because of what he's done or how he's behaved, behaved or his personality. He will be because, you know, the default position is that your footballers are your heroes. I was a boy once, and I remember Kenny Dalglish walked on water because he was a brilliant footballer.
So then what we need to do...
But can I just say, isn't one of the problems with one of the reasons why Ched Evans is perceived by a role model is we've seen over the last few weeks lots of people running around, for reasons I understand, saying Ched Evans is a role model.
Well, maybe, and they're wrong about that.
Exactly.
Yeah. But, you know, I myself don't actually see what's been going on in relation to the individual clubs as being a mob mentality. I think these are concerned men and women who have a real and deep concern about the way that...
OK, I want to take it into the audience.
..treated in society, and that does need to be tackled.
Please, Kate, I want to hear from the audience, and I want to hear from the audience while I say Kenny Dalglish was an exemplary role model. A brilliant man. The way he handled Hillsborough was fantastic, and he does not have a blemish. Yes, sir.
It was mentioned just a moment ago that the Football Association has dealt with racism and homosexuality and done a good job of that. That seems like self-preservation to me because there are many footballers of different races, so racism needs to be dealt with. Footballers are male, and so homosexuality, and we're generally talking about male homosexuals.
What meeting are we at?
So what I'm saying is that they're dealing with issues that are internal to themselves, whereas actually focusing on something which is external to themselves, which is what they should be doing, because... The footballers themselves are male, and many of the followers are male. Is to deal with the sexist attitudes.
Women's football is one of the fastest growing sports in the world.
Well, 100 years ago, there were lots of women playing football. It was actually banned by the FA. During the First World War, women were playing football in huge numbers, and the FA decided to ban it as unfeminine. But I agree with you about Kenny Dalglish. I think he's a great guy. I think he's a role model. Where we're at, I think it's important that the point, if we are going to say it's not about Ched Evans, and I agree, then what do we do? How do we question where are the messages coming to our young men telling them that consent doesn't matter? So let's talk about, for example, the sport. Let's talk about the fact that we've got a newspaper that's being sold that's pornographic, that ankle height. So page after page after page
owned by David Sullivan,
who owns 56% of West Ham United FC, who are getting the Olympic Stadium. Our council taxes helping subsidise that. How have we got to a place where page after page after page of stories of violence against women juxtaposed with naked women is being sold, and our children are seeing those, and our children are learning, and our sons are learning that consent doesn't really matter?
So let's leave you back there. Hello, in the room.
Hi, good morning. I just thought it was interesting what everyone was saying about the fact that he's not necessarily a role model and that, well, that he shouldn't be. But I think the unavoidable fact is that he is a role model, and that's why we've seen, as well as pointed out, people campaigning in the streets for him to be back on the pitch. But I think when you become a professional footballer, especially of his calibre, with that comes a certain amount of responsibility, which I think he shirked in this awful act that he committed. And if we're going to accept him back in the public light, he should be offering some kind of positive contribution, which, as far as I can follow, he's not done by not accepting.
Yeah, I'd agree.
This is part of the argument. That sense of decency, the clubs should work harder to inculcate into their players. Julian Harper, Lib Dem MP.
Thank you. There are two issues here. One is about the rape, and there's no excuse for rape. You know, alcohol never is one. The key is to get across that idea of consent, what consent really means. Part of that starts at school. We have sex education, which focuses on the mechanics, but actually needs to do much more about what is consent, what is OK, what's an acceptable relationship. Everybody should have that. That's part of that big conversation. It needs to happen for adults as well. The second point is the one about rehabilitation. We do have a huge problem with people who come out of prison and who are just left, not looked after, not supported. We need to help people to rehabilitate, to get back into jobs, to get employment, to get a stable life together. That is really important. We have laws around that, the Rehabilitation of Offenders Act. And that doesn't guarantee people... It could be improved, I agree. That doesn't guarantee people a job with a particular place. So should Ched Evans be able to get a job? Probably yes. That doesn't mean that a particular club or any club should be required to give him a job, Nicky, given what he has done. Nicky, he has not shown the appropriate process.
So what I would like to see, first of all, a number of people were complaining that Ched Evans had not apologised. And I think the statement, although I know it's not been satisfactory for some people, the statement he's put out in the last few days is a step in the right direction, acknowledging... No, it's not enough, but it's a step in the right direction. What I would like to see is if a club is minded to sign Ched Evans, I'd like them to put their money where their mouth is. So I'd like them to say, for example, right, we're going to match his weekly wage with money that we are going to put aside to funding and tackling sexism within football, to supporting organisations...
I think we just have to go through a bit of a thought experiment here, because people are saying that he's not a role model. You know, a 7-8-year-old, whether we tell him he's not a role model or not, is going to look up to somebody who plays football very well. And what I'm thinking is the following. Somebody who's been convicted for rape and pending appeal is, as of yet, and so he's been found guilty for rape, is as of yet not accepting responsibility for his own actions, and certainly hasn't said I'm sorry to the woman concerned. What I'm imagining is the following. Thousands of young children wearing his name on the back of their T-shirts, while when interviewed, this man says, I did nothing wrong. I don't believe I did anything wrong. That, whether we like it or not, is a very, very uncomfortable situation.
But if it were to come to that, his name on the back, would still be quite a statement.
Right, so what do we do? So the question is the following. I think, you know, I wouldn't personally employ a man who's been convicted of rape, especially if they're not accepting that they did anything wrong. However, I think the FA does need a level of consistency here. There are footballers who've accidentally killed people and they are playing. We have people who have been convicted for manslaughter in the House of Lords. And I think there needs to be consistent policy around these sorts of issues where people are in positions of great responsibility or prominence, that they are not glorified or glamorized in this way. But it is an issue for the FA to really be consistent around.
More than that.
Two very, very quick points. Firstly, I utterly agree with the point that, you know, there's a lot of focus on one case. It's a much wider problem. I've been talking about the much wider problem for years and years and years, and I have to say, this is the first time anybody's listened to me, so my apologies if I pick up on this one case and go, yes, somebody's listening about violence against women, and use it as a brilliant cornerstone to talk about it. But secondly, let me address Julian, you know, who is a Lib Dem MP, about the issue of sex education in school. I agree, it's vital, it's crucial, and yet free schools and academies are no longer required to teach any sex education whatsoever under this government, and that is an absolute travesty.
Or relationship education. That's it. Poor old Julian, but I'll be back with you, don't worry. You can join me in all this morning's debates logging on to bbc.co.uk/thebigquestions. Follow the link to the online discussion. You can tweet using the hashtag BBCTBQ. Now, tell us what you think about our last big question too. Should humanists have equal rights to religions? If you'd like to be an audience at a future show, you can email audiencetbq@menton.tv. We're going to be in Salford on the 25th of January, Glasgow on the 1st of February, and Southampton on the 8th. Well, just before Christmas, the government quietly dropped the idea of allowing humanists to legally conduct weddings, despite its review finding that a majority of people were in favour of the idea. In Scotland, since humanist weddings were made legal, they've proved extremely popular. Now more people are choosing marriage over just living together. Great success. Well, now the British Humanist Association is lobbying for humanism to be on the exam syllabus for GCSE, AS and A-levels in religious studies. Should humanists have equal rights to religions? Well, from Discuss Jesus, Tewo, from whom we heard earlier on, we were discussing this just before the programme and talking about, for example, humanist weddings, and you were saying you thought they were demonic.
I do, yeah, I think... I do think they're entirely demonic. It all goes back to the origins of humanism. Humanism is the cancer of Thanksgiving. It is the devil's PR. It is a first-class ticket to the sea of wantonness and debauchery, of every form.
I'm glad we're talking about
the reason. No.
There's a great thing about this program. I'm glad because I hope people appreciate that we try and give a range of opinions. There are plenty of people who agree with you. Are there?
I'm sure. There are a number of
free speech.
I like to think that
freedom of speech.
See, The issue with humanism is that it tries to knock God off the throne. And when we look at the Bible talks about Lucifer, whose name is the devil. And his attempt was to ascend to the Most High and sit on both sides of the north and basically replace God. And it's the same spirit, the same
subverts
mindset.
Subverts God, right.
Exactly.
In Scotland, it has bolstered the institution of marriage. You probably won't like this, but there have been pagan weddings. I know, of course you won't like it.
There have been white eagle lodge weddings,
which is a New Age philosophy. There have been spiritualist weddings, people who talk to the other side and my back. So,
see, I don't think this is good for society because God instituted marriage. God, based on the word of God, he brought Adam and Eve together. And so the very historical book which has stood the test of time is the very guideline we ought to follow. And I think humanism is a first-class ticket to the very hyper-sexualised culture that we're seeing.
Right. Andrew Copson, what is... before we cast you out, and all your works, what is... I'm serious. What is humanism?
Well, if you're going to go to wantonness and debauchery, I suppose you might as well travel first class. And I think that humanism is, in a genuine sense, more of a first-class worldview than has been depicted. Humanism is the non-religious worldview that, instead of looking to revelation or authority, we look to reason and evidence to understand the universe. Instead of looking to moral rules that come from outside human beings, we look to other human beings to generate values in the here and now, and also to generate meaning in our life. Instead of looking externally for some meaning to give value and sanction to the existence that we're having, a humanist view is that men and women in the course of our lives create and sustain meaning together by giving our lives purpose and a sense of fulfillment. Now, I think that is a very satisfying worldview, a worldview that has made a massive contribution to human progress and achievement. It's a worldview that is held by a very large number of people in Britain, over a third in opinion polls, by many people.
Do you think a lot of those people would not call themselves humanists? They don't know they're humanists.
That's right. I think that's a very interesting point of view. I mean, about 40% of people in Britain share those attitudes and beliefs and values, but about 5% of people call themselves humanists, which is about the same number as...
I disagree.
A result of a survey is a result, so why don't you just... choose whether that fact is true or not. And that view, which has made that powerful contribution to human well-being and motivates, for example, me to sit here politely listening to being called wanton and debauched rather than trying to interrupt other people... not on a Sunday morning, is worthy of respect. Now, when it comes to areas of our public common life, like what we learn about in schools, it is right that we should learn about religions and respect other people's points of view, as I would always do and you would not. But if we're learning about that, we should also be learning about humanist views. That's my opinion. And as you say, in Scotland, humanist weddings have been massively popular. Last year, they overtook the Catholic... Did you just say Pol Pot? Do you want to go through a list of Christians who've killed millions as well, or are you just going to put out one?
Okay, I want to move from the Khmer Rouge to the Reverend Rose.
They're your role models.
From the Khmer Rouge to the Reverend Rouge.
It's cheddar.
It's just Rose.
It's just Rose.
Rouge.
What do you? What problem do you have with this?
In the light of what you have just said, I am quite puzzled as to why an organization or a group that is anti-religion is then trying to ape the religious practices.
We're also talking schools and education.
But why are they trying to have that in the slot called the religion?
What's your problem with that?
For me, marriage is a sacred act. We see it as something really sacred, a gift from God, as it were.
In a registry office, if people...
Yes, and so it is not. It is not something that we think anybody just gets up and stand in front and say, yes, I'm marrying you.
Are you opposed to civil weddings?
No, I'm not opposed to civil weddings. I am specifically in this context. If humanists are anti-religion and anti-anything to do with that, I don't understand why you then want to ape and do all the things that religion does. I don't understand it.
Can I ask one question of Rose, then I'll be with you, Julian and Andrew. Mm. If you knew somebody who was a friend who invited you, would you go to a humanist wedding?
I don't know. I've never been to a humanist wedding.
Well,
and
I
don't know anyone.
Because let me tell you, as someone who has a faith, as a rabbi, I'm not a humanist, but I do respect that there are different ways of looking at life.
Why do you pause?
I pause because I genuinely don't know.
What is there not to know of? If a friend invites you to a wedding, why would you go?
It depends on what my views of what a wedding is.
Did you go to a Muslim wedding?
Sir Julian Harper. I'm slightly flabbergasted. I'm disappointed by somebody who's, I think, supposed to be my chaplain in the House of Commons, who has such a dismissive view of anybody that's not her own.
There are lots of people
who will celebrate things in different ways. Humanist funerals are incredibly popular, incredibly moving, and you're happy with those. You're not good.
I have been to a funeral.
The idea that marriage should be the sole preserve of a religious belief, I find very upsetting. Lots of people
want to have humanist weddings that fit
with their beliefs. Marriage,
the institution marriage
massively predates the Bible.
Wait, Julian Harper, please.
And I'm sure, Tamer, in a minute,
and I will come to you, Kate. I want to hear from Tamer again, but I want to hear the clear, calm voice of Julian.
Marriage predates the Bible. It's not purely from the Bible. I would hope you wouldn't be advocating many of the practices in the Bible around marriage, which we have now substantially moved away from. So there are lots of people in England who want to get married, who want to have a humanist celebration, because that is their belief system. And I cannot understand why people would want to say that a group of people who want to get married in a certain way, which would be a very pleasant way to do it, that fits with their beliefs, very, very decent approach, should be banned from doing so. I am incredibly disappointed the Prime Minister vetoed it. I think it's a great shame. We managed to get legislation into the Same-Sex Marriage Act, which I'm very proud of, that means that any future government can enable humanist weddings. So I think something I would like to see implemented as soon as possible. We've seen it being a huge success in Scotland. You know, something like 3,000 people have gone through this, the third most popular there. That's something we should all support for people who wish to have a humanist wedding. No one should be forced to, but nobody should be banned from it.
Tay will come back briefly, and Kate and so you're all on my list.
See, I think...
And audience, please, if you want to express a view on this... See, you're not looking happy about what you're hearing.
No, I'm not happy about the whole kind of humanist doctrine that, you know, they want to kind of, you know, force down people's throats.
That's
effective. And what's funny is, like, you know, they're trying to copy the very things that the Bible does.
Are you worried about the teachings in the schools as well?
I think that's another issue as well. Mm. You know, teaching young people about, you know, basically saying that there's no God.
How do you feel about teaching young people evolution?
I think that's a lie. I genuinely think that's a lie. Mm. Because if we are evolving, what are we evolving to?
Mm-hmm.
Can I make this point as well? Mm. If we are subject to matter, time and space, then if it's finite, how did it come to being?
Mm. Okay, so,
well, I'll answer that. I've got about 5 minutes.
I want
to respond to what our friend
here said. There's quite a lot to go on there, but just respond to
jumping in very, very quickly. First of all, this idea that humanists and secularists are somehow aggressively forcing their ideas. Like, I don't know, I've lived in my house for about 10 years, and I would say about once a fortnight, someone comes around and knocks on my door and tries to convince me to become a Christian or a Muslim, and on one occasion a Rastafarian. But nobody has ever come around my house to try to demand that I adopt secular individual values.
Let me finish. You mock, you insult God.
Let me just move straight on from there.
You have no idea about the historical value of the Bible.
I have a great amount of idea about the historical value of the Bible, and it's rather
like
low.
Rude.
Let me finish. I think that we live in a very messed up society. If we say, aren't relationships great? Aren't long-term relationships great for our culture? Doesn't this add something to our society? Isn't this great? Let's celebrate them. And if this person wants to help people celebrate them because he believes in a person from 2,000 years ago who turned water into wine and raised the dead and walked on water and all this kind of stuff, fair enough. But if my cousin Sarah wants to do it, who's a lovely, warm-hearted, caring, reasonable, rational individual, well, we couldn't possibly accept that.
Well,
that
marriage,
is an absolute nonsense.
Reverend Rose, why do you want to stop... and then, Jonathan, you can respond to this. Why do you want to stop her lovely cousin?
My fictional cousin, Sarah. But she's a dream.
Well, you've just been accusing him of fictional people. And you're making her... Does she walk on water as well?
I have actually never said that I wanted to stop it. I said I did not understand why they wanted... Having said religion is out, why they're...
Well, you're right about schools. You're right about education in schools. People teaching these...
Well,
A lot of religious people believe in secularism. Let's just say that.
Schools are places of learning.
Humanist values.
Yes. Schools, places of learning are good places to have that debate. I have no problem with children wrestling with those issues that they're going to grow up and be a part of in their society.
Jonathan,
no anxiety.
Yeah, and that's right. Schools are about education, not indoctrination.
Absolutely.
At least they should be. And therefore, if this is a view shared by a significant part of the country, it's not my view, but it's other people's view, then it should be represented. And by the way, we religious people actually have to say a sort of thank you to the humanists, because the earlier debate about freedom of speech. Freedom of speech was never a religious value. It wasn't in Judaism, Christianity or Islam. Unfortunately, we've had to learn it from the secular world. We've taken it on board, but this is an example where actually we can have some interfaith, interreligious dialogue.
Douglas has been trying to... we've had you, sir. Has anyone else been having... blue shirt, yeah.
Couple of points. Firstly, Rose said humanism is anti-religious. I'm a humanist. I'm not anti-religious. The main point I wanted to make about the marriage thing is there are basically two models you can have. In France, everybody has to go to the town hall, they register the wedding, and then after that, they can do whatever they want. In this country, we don't have that model. And that's fine. Nobody wants to force the French model onto us. But it just seems incomprehensible that one group of people, as appears to be represented by the Church of England, wants to prevent another group of people, me, from having a wedding which is legally recognised. The message to me is that I'm a second-class citizen.
Douglas, you wanted to come in. We started with you right at the beginning of the show. Seems like a long time ago now.
We have, by the way, seen a very good demonstration of why it's important to retain the ability to mock. and it is, and I hope we would do it with somebody who has had as... I respect you partly because you have actually been willing to say what you believe, and I think that is very important, because a lot of people don't. I would hope that, incidentally, if it was a devout Muslim who felt that we would feel as confident to mock and laugh at your views. I'm not sure we would. But if I could just say, the thing is that really, I mean, it is appalling that humanists can't marry if they want to. One of the things you absolutely know is that when you turn on the television and you see some act of violence, you know it's not going to be a humanist.
Marriage is
you
not
for
you.
Marriage
is not for you.
Do you have a... I don't know if you do or not, but do you have a thought on this? Humanism in schools, humanist marriages? Are you supportive?
It's important to learn about different things, so yeah.
That's it. I think that's a very neutral view.
Imagine no eyes.
It never ceases to amaze me that people that believe in an omnipotent and omnipresent...
You got married recently, didn't you?
Yes, I did, yes.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Civil registry and a kind of mixed and non-faith wedding. We won't go into that too much, but I am now happily married. People that believe in an omnipresent and omnipotent God who is all-powerful, it just never ceases to amaze me that people who believe in that concept are perennially worried about, to quote the gentleman, knocking God off his throne. I don't understand how two chaps, well, a man and a woman, or a man and a man, getting married in some place in Preston or wherever, right, are going to knock God off his throne. And what it does really tell me is of the terrible, terrible insecurity within people that insist in the certainty of their beliefs. Whether it's about cartoons or it's about not recognising humanist weddings or generally not recognising something else. I mean, the long pause we heard from the lady when asked about whether she'd go to her friend's wedding who's a humanist, that long silence indicates that level of insecurity in one's own selves. And it's whether it's cartoons or humanist weddings, in fact, because the gentleman was saying that he doesn't believe in mocking a prophet, yet sat there and mocked someone else's beliefs, and in fact...
We have to leave it there. Thank you all very much indeed. As always, debates continue online and on Twitter. Back next week. Thank you.